lofty hills in grandeur meet, and tall meandering flows. Here is a calm and sweet retreat, where once a mansion rose. Here dwelt Sir James of Oxenham, a brave and liberal lord. Benighted travellers never went unwelcome to his board. His lady long before it died, a son had never known, and Margaret, his age's pride, was heir to him alone. Oft had he prayed to see his child in happy wedlock bound, for her first love had only smiled to strike a deeper wound. Bertram, a young and valiant knight, did first her love obtain, but he received in feudal fight a bruise upon his brain. And although he died not from that strife, the injury of his brain unfitted him for wedded life, for he became insane. When madness did his mind infect, his words were wild and lorn, of blaming Margaret of neglect, and treating him with scorn. Fair Margaret's sorrow to remove, long strove her tender sire, but arguments to stifle love add fuel to the fire. Consoling time alone can heal the heart with anguish grieved. The magic balms around it steal and soothe it unperceived. A year with tales, commissions fraught, left Bertram still the same, but calming thoughts to Margaret brought that quenched the former flame. Her wreathing tress is dark and sleek, no more neglected flow. The soft vermilion of her cheek again begins to glow. Then John the Knight of Roxman Cave sought her fair hand again, and he was handsome, young and brave. How could he plead in vain? He fondly pressed his Margaret to fix their nuptial day, and on its joyful eve they met with friends and kinsfolk gay. And then that night in Oxenham Hall a sumptuous banquet found, the vaulted roof and panelled wall did with their mirth resound. How happy was Sir James that night, unburdened of his care, for he believed with fond delight that heaven had heard his prayer. He looked around with joy and glee upon his merry guests, for sparkling wine and minstrelsy had gladdened all their breasts. Then up he rose with joy elate to speak unto Sir John, and wrapped desire on speeding fate, in thought he called him son. But while the dear unpracticed word was forming on his tongue, he saw a silvery-breasted bird fly o'er the festive throng. Quickly as astral meteors fleet and lose their brilliant light, Sir James fell back upon his seat, pale and entranced with fright. His courteous guests with terror gaze, his daughter screamed aloud. Then all at once, distressed, amazed, confused around him crowd. But when his firmness he regained, he kept his fear suppressed, and temporary spasms feigned for seeming so distressed. He strove to cheer his friends again, but gloom o'erwrenched his brow, that sprang not from corporeal pain, but deep and thoughtful woe. And such a cloud upon their joy could not be soon expelled, when they perceived some sad annoy Sir James's bosom swelled, that soon they all retired to rest and sunk in sweet repose. But as Sir James's daughter blessed, his tears unbidden rose. Yet he his lonely chamber sought when left by every guest, but from the pain of fearful thought in vain he courted rest. And now he deemed it might for show his brother would be slain, who then was fighting with the foe in Italy or Spain. But from his friends he had concealed the cause of his dismay, lest it should gloom and sorrow yield on Margaret's wedding day. The moon shook many a roseate ray, and through his window smiled, as if to hail the nuptial day of Oxenham's only child. Up rose Sir James, his friends to meet, he drove his gloom away, resolved his fear should not defeat the purpose bright all day. Soon all were met, and many a fair with youth and beauty beamed, but none with Margaret could compare, her look so heavenly seemed. With joy they saw Sir James appear, restored and free from care, and when the appointed hour drew near, to church they did repair. Sir John and Margaret led the way, each on a milk-white steed. Then all the guests in rich array did gallantly succeed. A palfrey with comparison to see tonight and dame, Sir John's esquire led stately on till to the church they came. Sir John and Margaret on that steed together mean to ride, when from the church they take the lead in holy wedlock tide. A numerous and promiscuous throng to see them wed disposed, rushed in the church the guests among before the doors were closed. Now John and Margaret and her sire, with many a dame and knight, ranged round the altar, heard the friar begin the holy rite. When Margaret with terrific screams made all with horror start, oh, heavens, her blood in torrents streamed, a dagger's in her heart. Behind stood Bertram, who then drew away his reeking blade, and frantically he laughed to view the lifeblood of his maid. Now marry me, proud maid, cried, thy blood with mine shall wed. Then dash flashed the dagger in his side, and on the ground fell dead. Poor Margaret, too, grows cold with death, and round her hovering flies the phantom bird for her last breath to bear it to the sky. In vain they staunch the ghastly wound, and then from church she's born. Not of the sun again pass round, ere she did there return. Thus on that cursed day began a legacy of pain for the white bird of the Oxenhams, ere to appear again.